My culture's in the dark. My religion is a question mark. Where do I start? And that has stuck with me for 30 years. And he helped me answer those questions because I realized that I did have, didn't need to be religion. It was more about spirituality and knowledge of self. And he took me in a place where I had a starting point. And then from there, I went from studying 5% mathematics, you know, all the way to 120. I didn't really, you know, master it, but then it opened up the doors for me to study other things.
Yeah, Rob was funky. Rob was jazz. Rob was funk. Rob was street, ratchet, ghetto, knock a nigga, bump a nigga, slam dancing, rub your bitch ass at the same time, stinking ass, blunt smoking, 40 tossing, fuck a nigga up all in one. Like Rob was the street. That was the street.
When somebody talked to me about Rod, he was a man child. Like LeBron James is on a basketball court. That's how he was with the pen.
Thinking of a master plan. This ain't nothing but sweat inside my hands. So I dig into my pocket, all my money spent. So I get deeper, but still coming up with lint. So I start my mission, leave my residence. Thinking how could I get some dead presidents? I need money. I used to be a stick-up kid. So I think of all the devious things I did.
I try to keep everything dealing with, you know, reality. You know what I'm saying? Just things that take place. Like I can be riding up a block. You know, somebody that's sitting next to me that's riding with me might, you know, think it's just a regular block. But, you know, what I see is like, you know, I see the way a kid is walking up the block and I try to think about what he's thinking about. You know what I'm saying? If I see a kid walking real slow, I can put it in a, you know, rhyme form. You know what I'm saying? His feelings. You know what I'm saying? I can see an area that's like burnt down or whatever. You know what I'm saying? What I try to do is picture life before it burnt down and where the people that were staying there, you know, what happened to them when it got, you know what I'm saying? It's like I try to look through things and, you know, come up with something different.
Popo Griffin.
Yeah.
Man, we went to school together he grew up in Wandange. Always lived right up the street one way or the other.
And I always admired Griff, you know, and all musicians. I wasn't a musician, but I was into DJing and things of that matter.
Rakim represents innovator, pioneer. These are the things, these are the words that I think of when I think of Rakim. Legend, you know, one of the first people to take lyricism to another level.
Rakim to this day, just to people, is still one of the greatest MCs ever. That's enough said.
And now you have everybody trying to duplicate the culture and duplicate my era, meaning that your jewelry you wear, your clothes you wear, and how you wear them, your haircut, the jewelry, your slang, everything comes from the culture.
It's been a long time.
In the beginning, William Griffin Jr. was surrounded by music. From his mom's being a singer and his brothers playing instruments, it was almost predestined that he would have something to do with sound or music before the age of 12. Jazz music, break beats, keyboards, turntables was his introduction to music and flows of melody.
My brother played the piano, my sister sang, my other brother played the sax and piano. I played the sax and drums, you know, so it's like, it helps me a lot when, you know, I sit down and write rhymes. I know different musical backgrounds and things of that nature. And it just, you know, put me that much deeper into it.
Me and Griff got together. He came over to my house and saw me making beats. And he brought his saxophone, so we had I had scratches and beats and break beats. He had his saxophone. Eventually, at some given point, we ended up with a keyboard because Griff knew how to play the keyboard, learned from his older brother, Ronnie.
Ra, peace to the God. Peace to the God. Peace to the Griffin family.
Peace to my brother, Stevie Blass.
Oh, man, what can I say about Rakim? I can say Rakim, I first met Rakim at 12 or 13-ish, about 12. Child prodigy.
I guess Blass admired what I was doing on the turntables. So Blass would come over, I would do some turntable stuff and teach him how to spin. And then eventually he would bring his saxophone over and I would scratch beats and run break beats. I would run break beats over his saxophone and then we would record that onto cassettes.
The Griffin family and my family, we're very close. The siblings, my brothers and sisters went to school. We all went to school together. Me and Stevie's a year apart. My brother, Leo, went to, and his sister Steph is about the same age. My sister Thea and Ronald, which is Rakim's oldest brother, is about the same age.
I think since I was young, man, because of the influences around me, you know, my oldest brother was already out there in the mix. My brother under him, Stevie Blass, that's the one that plays keyboards, moved the crowd and all that for me back in the day. Again, he played sax, my sister sang, so I was always around music. And, you know, back then coming up as a kid, you know, if it wasn't Michael Jackson or, you know, Stevie Wonder or, you know, Kool and the Gang, you know, we was always influenced by what was going on and we wanted to be stars, you know, at a young age. I know at least I did.
Well, doing something with the turntable and teaching him how to mix, and he was showing me records they had. Their mother and father had an incredible jazz collection. And we decided to go to the store to go buy some beer. So we left out the basement door, went to the store to buy a couple of quarts of beer. At this time, they didn't have 40 ounces. It wasn't invented yet. And when we got back, my turntable was spinning. And I was like, Blast, like, well, we didn't call him Blast at the time. I was like, Griff, who been messing with my turntable? And he turned and said, nobody. There's nobody down here. Nobody will come down here. I said, I never take my needle and leave my needle off the little holder there on the turntable. And why is the record spinning? Next thing you know, we heard some feet shuffling and this little dude went running up the steps and we went to go chase him and we couldn't catch him. He was too fast. And that's the first time I didn't meet him, but that was Rakim at 10 years old messing with my turntable, which is why today I say my turntable was the first professional turntable Rakim ever seen.
Known as Kid Wiz or Kid Wizard at first, he had the ferociousness of a lion, but was smooth as a bird in the wind on the mic. Everyone from his hood knew there was something special about William Griffin Jr. Known to be the youngest out of his crew, the Love Brothers, he began to make a name for himself right into high school.
And Rod was, I gotta say it, I know this sounds cliche and corny, but from the beginning he was special. I gotta give it to him. And everybody knew it.
I wasn't just hearing 1, 2, 3, 4. I was saying 1, 2, 3, and 4, and whatever. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I started realizing, yo, if I can, you know, fill in all of this space with rhythms and you know, intellectual words that, you know, grab them in 4 or 5 syllable words and wow. Know what I mean? I figured out, you know, I can make the same rhythms that he was making by using certain syllable words and using certain syllable words after each other. You know what I mean? So I took it from a float and a float and float and then gold and a blown and a to blown down diddle blown diddle blown.
My first MC name was Kid Wizard, man.
Can write rhymes, recite rhymes so smoothly to the point where you would think that he was doing a freestyle, but it wasn't really a freestyle, but it was a freestyle. But he would write it.
No, I just used to always thought if I can grab their attention from the first couple bars, then they'll listen to the rest of the song, you know what I mean? And also,
I don't know, the beginning of the song, the first thing you say on the song is almost, you know, and that's every song, is almost like, you know, your first impression.
And my affiliation with some of the groups, the old school hip-hop, Goofy Chill, had a little, some demo session with Rakim, plus, you know, the music, he was in the hood rapping, Kid Wiz, Kid Wizzy.
Rakim, as growing up, got with a few dudes that were neighbors with him. G-Stro.
Well, that's what I was hearing. G-Stro, him and Cool Breeze.
Stephen Pye was the Snake. Ron Drew.
Ballin' was the DJ. And,
So, when they got with Cool Breeze and the Love Brothers, it was like, you know, Cool Breeze had the system. He had the popularity and the MCs, and it was like that was a lot to deal with. And Rod was probably like 13, maybe barely 14 at that. And that's where that crew was like this. They took over the whole area. See, the thing about it too, like I said before, if you had a pass, like Amityville was doing their thing. Wine Dance, we was doing our thing. And the two parks and the 2 days you would do it at is Amityville Day and Wine Dance Day.
Everybody knew that there was backyard parties, and they knew they would wait for him to get on that mic, because I know he would destroy it, you know? They knew he was gonna say something innovative, and he was ahead of his time, you know? He wasn't a god then. He was the Kid Wiz at the time. You know, he was young. He was running with a lot of older dudes that was maybe 2, maybe 3 years older than him at the time. And he was doing things that maybe at his age he shouldn't have been doing.
It was like you knew Rakim was coming out with some new gear or some new whatever, or you knew Cool Breeze was going to bring a new record, or you knew Almighty G-Stro or Blade or Snake or Ron Drew, they was going to do something that they would attract 1,000 people in the park by themselves, because you want to know what they was doing, you know what I mean? They was like the next thing, you know? So yeah, they was a serious crew.
When I started hearing him on the radio, I mean, excuse me, on the and at the block parties back then, you know, I was like, man, this kid's nice. And I wanted to be so much a part and give my contribution into hip hop, into the hip hop culture, you know. I was like, yo, this dude, man, he might be, yo, he could do something, he could be something, you know.
Can write rhymes, recite rhymes so smoothly to the point where you would think that he was doing a freestyle, but it wasn't really a freestyle, but it was a freestyle. But he would write.
I hold the mic as hostage, I'm seized as ransom. Rhymes are punishing because they don't understand them. I heat up his brain, then explain, then I hand him a red hot microphone. That's how I brand them. Rhymes fall in formation, unite and ignite. Like a platoon putting bullet wounds in the mic. If you curse me, it ain't no mercy. Give him an autopsy, killed by a verse of me. I took a kid and cut off his eyelids. Kill him slow so he can see what I did. And if he don't understand what I said, I'm pushing his eyeballs way to the back of his head so we can see what he's getting into. A part of the mind that he never been through. The journey is coming because you're getting sent to a place harder to find, but it's all in the mental. I run a brain scan to locate his game plan. When I'm through with his brain, he ain't the same man. Did he lose his mind or lost in his mind? But this ain't the loss and found, because you can't find.
So in stacks and stacks of books he would have. Stacks and stacks. You mean just right. And when he pulled one out on you, it's a problem.
What I do when I'm writing, I'm putting down my life, you know what I'm saying? And you know, I don't believe in writer's block, so when I get to the point where, you know, I'm getting slow on the ink, I just put the pen down, then I go back out in the world and live. So, you know, I'm not rhyming, I'm just thinking, you know what I'm saying? So when I get back to the paper, I got more life to put down.
But he had done something, man, and it was a different thing he was doing, and he blew me away. I could never rhyme in front of him again after that. So he started to grow in popularity in the neighborhood. Those tapes that I made was circulating around the neighborhood.
The Love Brothers was a crew that helped Rakim sharpen his skills on the mic and develop that slow flow that is his trademark. Not too long after that, he would experiment with recording demos with local neighborhood producers and childhood friends, DJ Maniac and Nate Tinsley, along with Rakim's older brother, Stevie Blass.
We was producing music on cassette tapes. We couldn't get our hands on like a four-track recorder or nothing like that. All of that stuff was a little too expensive at the time. We couldn't afford it. So we just did our thing. And there was a couple of other people that was involved, like Nate Tinsley.
That was his thing, you know, the God of C thing. It's real, original man talking the birthplace. And I looked at that heavy, because when you find yourself, no matter where you are, it doesn't matter, Africa or the tip of the web, wherever you find yourself and that real self comes out, you know it, and you met it. That's the new birthplace of original man right there, you know. So it happened in Wine Dance for some of us. You know, that's the birthplace, man.
When I talk about him, his charisma was like, he just had a whole way of doing his thing. So the things that he would do and say was just totally different from what everybody else was doing.
You know, some time went by, a long time had gone by, and Rakim was in high school at this time, and he used to stop over every now and again with a couple of his friends, you know, because I had my music set up in the basement, and they would listen to music. And we would, you know, drink and chat, you know, smoke a little something. And one day I hear knocks at my window, or at my door rather, because my bedroom was on the second floor. I look out my window, it's Rakim, he's by himself. I'm like, what's up? He's like, yo, you gotta help me, man. I got this melody in my head, I gotta get it out.
But at the same time, like I said, he was serious about it. He loved hip hop, and you could tell at an early age that he was not messing around. He was just had a talent to rhyme. He was God's gift.
Came downstairs, had my equipment set up in the living room at this point, let him in, and he started humming this melody. He was like, can you play that? I'm like, of course I can play that. I mean, your brother taught me how to play the keyboard. So I said, it goes like this.
Eric B in the crib, took him downstairs, a little basement area. Mom and Pop had hooked up real nice, throw the joint in. And there was like a long version of my melody. You know what I mean? So Eric B heard it.
Hold on, what beat? Who did the beat?
His brother played on it.
Oh, your brother played my melody.
Yeah, we used to go to my man Maniac house, this kid Paul Garrard. Big up to Maniac. We used to go to his crib. He had like a nice little setup where we can kind of make little beats, you know what I mean? Casios and, you know, shit like that back in the day. But it was nice, man. But, you know, we used to go over there and do my little thing.
He kept going, do, 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 do. So I just found the keys, played it. I said, is that it? He was like, that's it. So I recorded a beat from a Boss Dr. Rhythm along with the keyboard part. We recorded that onto a cassette. Then we took the cassette and put it into a player, another cassette player, played it through the mixer again onto another cassette that was recording. And I added scratches and he rhymed over this echo chamber. And there you have the melody. The melody was made in my living room with me and Rakim that morning.
During Rakim's high school years, he developed a relationship with another budding Long Island rapper by the name of Biz Markie. The two would forge a friendship based off their love for clothes and music.
If your toes is too close, you're gonna fall in a trap. Oh yeah, what do you need with the likes of them? One who knows the rhyme and any old sin on him. Got hair so heavy you can almost swim. By the person who you can tell us Rakim. Take 7 MCs, put them in a line. Add 7 more brothers, you think they can rhyme. It'll take another 7 before I go for mine. That's 21 MCs, they the fastest they time.
But Wine Dance High School, do you remember this?
World up, world up. And what's dope is Biz Mark used to always come out to Long Island to our high school, man. He would come up in the school, and the security guards would try to kick him out. So I had a little juice. I was like, nah, he good, man. He just came up here. I'm taking to see the band teacher, man. You know what I mean? Meanwhile, me and Biz back in the lunchroom. He beatboxing, and I'm rhyming.
Biz Mark would convince Ra that to totally test his skills, they would have to go into the concrete jungle called the Five Boroughs.
We're 201 Uptown, one of the high schools there. And Biz invited us out to this battle.
Battling at the high school, battling in Harlem. So I started, you know, incorporating battle rhymes. And like this right here, most of that was freestyle.
It was Rakim, myself, my man Scully, my man Mike Mitchell, and Biz.
Like whenever I would get down with Biz, we just rhyme off the top of the head. And then you throw a couple joints you had made already in there.
Dougie Fresh goes in there, and you know, you got Rob Bass in there before he made records, and he had all the Uptown cats that was, you know, that was live, Eminem, Kid West, you know. So, you know, these cats we heard about, but we never seen. So we was like just playing in the cut.
You know, I met Biz like, you know, early 80s, man. He came out to Wine Dance and had on some painted shell tops one day. I had to paint the shell tops on.
Dougie was here, Biz was here. So it's you know, competition there. So all of a sudden, it was Biz's turn to get on, and Dougie Fresh started basically dissing Biz on the mic. And we was like, word? Is this and Biz? Nah, that's our man. You know, listen, we gonna do this. We gonna do this. So Rod's sitting there in the cut, like, just perusing everything, just like, just building up. And he like, yo, B, get that impeach the president ready. Get that impeach the president ready.
Started talking, and before I know it, I found out he rapped. He found out that, you know, that I rapped. So, you know, we start kicking it.
You know, Barry B just shoves the headphones in my chest, kind of like, and I'm like, whoa, for real? Okay, now I'm hot now. I'm ready to cut it up on somebody, getting ready to slice somebody up. Rob was like on some, yo, let's go. He jumps up on the table, on a small little table, and he goes, he says one of his intros. Then in the bass, come on, Super B, let's dog the pace. Yes, y'all. Boom, I throw that record in. And when he, all of a sudden, he did the seven MCs in a line rhyme. And everybody was just stuck on stupid.
That's when I was starting to do a lot of battle rapping, and that little seven MC theory just came into play. Well,
it was just like everybody was like, yo, who is this dude? Who is this dude that just came here in Uptown and shook everybody up? Not only shook everybody up, he had everybody's girl.
Rakim had another childhood friend by the name of Alvin Tony, who had already reached success at the time in hip hop by his association and relationship with EPMD. Eric B happened to come to Long Island looking to sign the next big act and asked Alvin for his advice. Two names came up, Rakim and Freddie Fox.
What I was going to do was, when I first started, I was going. We used to go to Tri-State, we used to Connecticut, New Jersey, New York. So we used to play, you know, we used to go every street team. We take t-shirts, buttons, hats, jackets, and, you know, give them out to the neighbors and promote BLS. So I was going to do a record. I was going to do an album called The Tri-State and just go, because in Connecticut, I used to find rappers that were nice, in New Jersey and New York. So I was going to just take a rapper from, you know, all these different boroughs and the Tri-State and put them together and do an album.
Like a compilation
album. Of course.
Right.
Then wind up going to Long Island, and I just, Wine Dance just kept, every weekend they would call, oh, we want Eric to come back. So I played,
because you rocked
literally,
it.
Literally right. Every week I would play another street in Wine Dance. Right. It was the most ridiculous thing in the world. So every week I'd be on this street, that street, every weekend in Wine Dance. So I met a guy named Alvin Tony.
Well, Alvin
he might have had something to do with that, because he's, you know, very influential in certain aspects in the game for a minute. You know, a lot of stuff with EPMD.
You know, it's possible, because I think Alvin Tony knows Freddie Fox.
You know, he was managing them and Craig Mack, and
A friend of mine named Alvin Tony, you know, was with Eric, and he mentioned to Eric, was like, "Yo, take me to, you know, the MCs out here that's dope. I want to meet the dope ones, the ones that's nice, because I got a project I'm working on and blah blah blah."
Alvin Tony told me, "Eric, you know, we got rappers out here." Rappers and what? Man, Alvin, cut the shit.
This is Long Island. I mean,
yeah. Are you serious, man?
There's no rap in Long Island.
No. Alvin took me over there.
He said, "I know a kid that could rap."
Yeah, he took me to two people's house. Took me to Freddie Fox's house.
Well, I was driving through Wyandanch, and Alvin flagged me down, and he had Eric with him. And he was like, "Yo, man, this is Eric B. And, you know, he looking for somebody to do this project with."
He said, "Nah, Eric, I'm telling you, these guys are nice. I got this man, Freddie, man." Went over to Fox's house first, and he was telling Eric, "Man, he's the man. He's the man. I'm telling you, he's the man." Then we went over to Rakim's house.
Cat on my football team, Alvin Tony, brought Eric B to the crib and was like, "Yo, this is Eric B. He looking for an MC." And, you know, me being a little arrogant dude, I'm sitting there looking at Eric B like, like, "Yo, Al, man, I'm about to go to college to play football, man. What you bringing this dude over? I told you don't be bringing nobody to the crib, man." But he's like, "Yo, he know Magic and Molly Mall, and you know what I mean?" So I was like, "All right."
Just start talking, you know, he was home. We start talking and going, you know, back and forth, you know, about different things. I never forget, you know, when I went there, they used to call him Pop.
Right.
So up on the wall, he had wrote Rakim on the wall. I'll never forget this. In his room, he used to write stuff on the wall and wrote Rakim. I was like, "Yo." He was like, "Yo, I'm studying. You know, I'm a 5%. I'm studying.
I'm studying my lessons, right?"
Okay. You know, then that's the name we went with.
Right. Eric B and Rakim.
Yes.
Because the DJ always came first.
No. Actually, Rakim made up the name of the group.
Really?
Yes.
Eric B used to be my roommate. We used to see a lot of artists come through the studio and become stars. So when Eric B was scheduled to bring in his first rapper, guess what? His first rapper never showed up. Somebody told me that was Freddie Fox that was supposed to show up.
Then I told him, I said, "Okay, cool." So being that I was in a group, I was like, "Okay, we'll be there. You know, we'll be at a, we set up a meeting." I said, "We'll be there." He's like, "Well, who's we?" I was like, "Me and, you know, the other two cats that I rock with." Eric was like, "Well, I just need one of y'all." So I didn't cancel the meeting, but I didn't show up, because I felt like if he wasn't going to take all of us, it would have been kind of whack for me. I didn't want to bounce on my guys like that. So I kind of just didn't show up.
But the next day, a rapper did show up. And that rapper that showed up, his name was Rakim.
So that initial meeting is what got Rakim and Eric B together. They would take previous demos that Rakim made to the studio to show Marley Marl.
At some point, I guess Alvin Tony ran into Eric B. Freddie Fox must have missed the boat. Because the rumor has it that he was supposed to show up at that meeting. He didn't. Rakim showed up. And I guess he brought that tape of the melody, because Eric B. had to hear something.
When I first met him, I was in a maze. He had did this record that was 90. We had those Maxwell, is a Maxwell cassette tape. And he had my melody on it. And he rhymed for about 90 minutes on it. And I got the original cassette. I got to find the original cassette, because the record is the cut down edited version of my melody, because he rhymed for about 90 minutes on the tape.
So they took that tape of the melody and brought it to Marley Marl. So Marley Marl recreated the melody off of what I made. Me and Rakim made the melody.
Now, when Rakim first came to the studio, we made a song called My Melody first.
Turn up the bass, check out my melody, hand out a cigar. I'm letting knowledge be born, and my name's the R. A.K.A. I am not like the rest of them, I'm not on the list.
It was real slow, down tempo. The energy really wasn't there. And me and Eric had an idea.
So you trying to say that before you was cool, before... So he had the beat before you then?
He had the song.
He had the song.
Yeah, and he had music to it. He had the song and had the music already done.
The melody that you hear is pretty much just about the same thing. Because Eric B kind of copied my scratches and everything.
Turn up the bass, check out my melody, hand out a cigar. I'm letting Niles be born, and my name's the R. AKA I am not like the rest of them, I'm not on the list. That's what I'm saying, I drop lines like a scientist. My melody's in the code, the very next episode. Have the mic off and distorting, ready to explode. I keep the mic at Fahrenheit, freedom's easy to make.